We're going to move right on to our second speaker today, and that is Dr. Ellen Sidransky. She is chief of the section of molecular neurogenetics and a pediatrician and clinical geneticist in the medical genetics branch of the National Human Genome Research Institute. Her work covers clinical and basic research aspects of Gaucher disease and Parkinson's disease, as well as studies of genotype-phenotype correlation and genetic modifiers, clinical insights from mouse models, and the development of new treatment strategies for lysosomal storage disorders. She also focuses on understanding the complexity encountered in simple Mendelian disorders, the association between Gaucher disease and Parkinsonism, and the development of small molecule chaperones as a therapy for Gaucher disease and related disorders. Welcome, Dr. Sidransky.
Thank you very much, Sean. It's my pleasure to be here to tell you about our work that's being conducted here at NIH. I've chosen to focus on our projects on Gaucher disease and Parkinsonism, which you'll see is an evolving story. What I hope to show you today is how studies of rare recessive disorders can provide a window into more complex disorders, where in our case, by focusing a detailed examination of a single gene disorder, Gaucher disease, we've come up with insights that are applicable first to monogenic disorders, but ultimately might help unravel complex disorders like Parkinson's disease. So just to introduce, the two disorders that I'm focusing on are really quite different. Gaucher disease is a rare recessive single gene disorder. It's the deficiency of an enzyme leading to the accumulation of a lipid. There's variable age of onset, multi-organ involvement, and symptoms include enlarged livers and spleens, low platelet and blood counts, and at times bone and brain involvement. In contrast, Parkinson's disease is a common disorder affecting 1.5% of the population over age 65, and it's a complex multi-gene disorder with a late onset. It results from loss of dopaminergic neurons in the brain, and we see the accumulation of aggregates of proteins, including one that you'll hear about, alpha-synuclein, within bodies inside the brain that are known as Lewy bodies. The symptoms of Parkinsonism and Parkinson's disease include bradykinesia, which is slow movements, rigidity, tremor, and sometimes dementia. And it's a disorder that primarily affects the substantia nigra and brainstem regions. So how are these two disorders associated? I'm going to show you that by using an integrated translational approach with pathologic studies, clinical studies, genetic studies, imaging, cell biology, et cetera, we're beginning to gain some insight into this. So to begin with Gaucher disease, it's the inherited deficiency of the enzyme glucocerebrosidase, which cleaves a glucose moiety off of the lipid glucocerebroside. It's the most common lysosomal storage disorder and the most common inherited disorder among Ashkenazi Jews. It's a disorder primarily of the reticuloendothelial system, where lysosomes within macrophages become engorged with the stored lipid, giving rise to what you see on the left, the characteristic appearing Gaucher cell. And on the right, you're looking at an electron micrograph of a Gaucher cell, and the distorted organelle that you see there is actually a lysosome, which is engorged with this tubular storage material. There's vast clinical heterogeneity encountered in this single gene disorder. It's classically divided into three types, type 1 being non-neurologic, type 2 being acute neuronopathic, and type 3 being chronic neuronopathic. But having studied patients with this disorder for more than two decades now, I've really come to see it much more as a spectrum ranging from asymptomatic octogenarians to fetuses that succumb in utero with wide range of associated manifestations. And one of the groups that we started to appreciate was patients that develop Parkinsonian manifestations. So this association between what I'll call GBA, or the gene for glucocerebrosidase, and Parkinsonism was a story that really began here at the NIH Clinical Center with the observation of actually one particular patient who we were seeing for Gaucher disease who had pretty progressive Parkinsonism. We then noted that these two phenotypes were encountered sometimes in other rare patients. And then We also started to appreciate that Parkinson's disease was seen in relatives of our patients with Gaucher disease more often than we might expect. Then we and other groups around the world started to appreciate that there was an increased incidence of GBA mutations in patients with Parkinson's disease and with associated Lewy body disorders. However, actually, many of these initial studies were greeted with skepticism because of limitations of power and controls, and also because large genome-wide association studies had not identified this gene. But the associations persisted. And now glucocerebrosidase is considered the most common genetic risk factor for Parkinson's disease. In fact, if you just look in the last decade doing PubMed scans, the number of papers and studies on this gene related to Parkinson's disease is growing exponentially. Though I do want to emphasize that the vast majority of the patients that we see with Gaucher disease and the majority of Gaucher carriers are people with GBA mutations never develop Parkinson's disease. So it's a risk factor, but not a predictive gene. Well, one of the reasons why this began to become more accepted was several years ago, we spearheaded a multi-center study of glucocerebrosidase mutations in large groups of patients with Parkinson's disease. We collected genotypes from 16 centers spanning four continents and ultimately had over 5,000 genotypes from patients with Parkinson's disease and about the same number from controls. The bottom line was we determined that subjects with Parkinson's disease are over five times more likely to have a mutation in glucocerebrosidase, giving an odds ratio of over 5.4. We also noted that patients with Parkinson's disease that carried mutations tended to have a little bit earlier Parkinson onset, about 4 or 5 years, and we had the impression that there were more cognitive deficits. Just recently, we've actually gone back and done a very similar analysis with 11 different centers participating, where we looked for the frequency of glucocerebrosidase mutations in patients with an associated disorder, dementia with Lewy bodies. Here, there's a much more rapid progression of cognitive impairment, and it's a rarer disorder. So in this series, we collected about 700 cases. And actually, the odds ratio was greater than 8, suggesting that mutations in this gene play an even larger role in the dementias with Lewy bodies. At the clinical center, we've been following these patients for about a decade now, and our studies focus both on clinical features and PET imaging. We collaborate with Karen Berman's group in the National Institute of Mental Health. The goals of the study are to look at fluorodopa uptake and to evaluate PET as a surrogate marker in patients that in subjects that have glucocerebrosidase mutations, and to see if we can find the earliest signs of Parkinson's disease in this at-risk cohort. So in our studies, we recruit patients that have both Gaucher disease and Parkinson's disease. We're also looking at Gaucher patients and Gaucher carriers who have a positive family history of Parkinsonism. Patients come to the NIH and undergo fairly routine physical, neurologic, and neurocognitive evaluation each time. We do olfactory testing and screens for non-motor symptoms of Parkinsonism to see if we can find some signs of early involvement. The imaging studies include MRI, fluorodopa PET studies for dopa metabolism. We do radioactive water studies to evaluate cerebral blood flow, and we're evaluating transcranial sonography. We just recently published the results in our first 40 patients that we've studied. And basically, we found that patients with Parkinsonism that also had Gaucher disease had fluorodopa uptake that was very similar to patients that just had sporadic Parkinson's disease. Where we did see differences were in the cerebral blood flow studies, where we see some changes that are more characteristic of disorders with cognitive impairment. And this study is ongoing. So how can mutations in a metabolic enzyme lead to Parkinson's disease? Well, the verdict is not out, but there's certain hypotheses to consider. One is that we know that the formation of insoluble alpha-synuclein aggregates contribute to the neuronal cell death that occurs in Parkinsonism. So the gain of function hypothesis is that having this mutant enzyme around could somehow lead to an increase of an aggregate formation, as you see on the right, or it could lead to organelle dysfunction, particularly the lysosome, leading to decreased aggregate clearance, both cases contributing to these aggregates that contribute to neuronal cell death. But another hypothesis would be that this is a loss of function, that having the mutant glucocerebrosidase around leads to an unstable or deficient protein that's degraded, and then you don't have enough enzyme, so the lipid accumulates, and the accumulation of this lipid could lead to neuronal cell death. And then another theory that was recently published by our group in collaboration with the group at Mass General is that it could be even more involved. There could be something like what we call the bidirectional feedback loop, where there's indications that having increases in this lipid level of glucosylceramide lead to increased soluble alpha-synuclein oligomers and fibrils, and having these around would contribute to alpha-synuclein aggregates in neuronal cell death. At the same time, having these insoluble aggregates around seems to block the ER-Golgi trafficking of the enzyme, which again would lead to increased lipid accumulation and it compounding the problem in a vicious cycle. In collaboration with Jennifer Lee's group and NHLBI, we've also done some biophysics studies, and we feel that there is likely a molecular link between alpha-synuclein and our enzyme glucocerebrosidase. This was shown by several different techniques, including fluorescence spectroscopy, NMR, and co-immunoprecipitation studies, though the association only appears to be only appears to occur at pH 5.5 and not pH 7. The interaction between the two proteins appears to occur at the C-terminus of alpha-synuclein. So this binding at lysosomal pH could facilitate alpha-synuclein degradation or prevent aggregation. Also, this GBA story implicates the lysosome in PD pathogenesis. Now I'm going to move on a little bit towards some of the work that we've been doing in therapeutics. And one approach that we've been looking at as a therapy for Gaucher disease is chemical chaperone therapy. The protein glucocerebrosidase is synthesized in the ER, and it's glycosylated and folded, but it doesn't reach its tertiary functional structure until it's actually in the lysosome, as you see the top panel on the right. If you have a mutation in the enzyme, it's likely that it will not fold correctly, and it will be degraded, and none of it will get to the lysosome. So our strategy is to come up with small chemicals that are known as chemical chaperones that can bind to the mutant protein, stabilize it, and so that it's at least partially corrected and it can get to the lysosome where it can still function. So in collaboration with the NCGC, the National Chemical Genomic Screening Center, we've been conducting high-throughput screening of large libraries of small molecules to see what might impact the enzyme activity in glucocerebrosidase. And in fact, recently we took a new approach and we actually used a patient's spleen sample as our source of mutant enzyme. In this high-throughput screen, we evaluated 250,000 compounds at 7 different concentrations. Fortunately, there's robots to do this work, and identified 30 new non-inhibitor chaperones that we're very excited about. Our lead chaperones look like they can improve the translocation of the enzyme to the lysosome in patient fibroblasts. And in macrophages, I'm going to show you, the compound seems to reverse storage. So the small molecule therapies like this may stabilize mutant glucocerebrosidase and also be used to treat Gaucher disease as well as possibly Parkinson's disease. Well, one problem that we had with this drug development is that we didn't have a really good model for showing reversal of storage, which is what you target in Gaucher disease. So in the last few years, we've been working to develop induced pluripotent stem cells as a model for Gaucher disease, beginning with patient fibroblasts. We generated the appropriate embryoid bodies and then showed that our cells make the appropriate markers, have the right karyotype, they can go on to form teratomas. We differentiated them first into monocytes and then macrophages. And to our excitement, we were able to determine that Gaucher macrophages can show the storage, which we were never able to demonstrate before. We think this model will be very useful for drug development and for understanding pathophysiology. And to demonstrate this, so what we do, if you see the two fluorescent images below, one is of a control macrophages generated from induced pluripotent stem cells, and on the right is a Gaucher. When you feed these cells with labeled erythrocyte ghosts, you can appreciate that only the fluorescent storage is much, much greater in the Gaucher macrophages. Then we take these macrophages and we treat them with our best chaperones. So the top panel is the control, and the second two panels, the two lower panels are macrophages from patients. When in the very last column to the right, we've added our lead chaperone, and you can see that we're seeing a reversal of the storage, indicating that this does seem to have promise. So I hope that I've shown you that understanding the links between these two disorders can prove to be quite fruitful, teaching us about the pathogenesis of both disorders, providing some clues into the role of lysosomes in the development of Parkinsonism, and then ultimately it may yield improved genetic counseling and new therapeutic strategies. And I just want to briefly acknowledge all the people in my group who've done this work, my close collaborators here at NIH and around the world, and of course to give special thanks to patients, family members, and the referring physicians who have contributed to these studies. Thank you.